Joining us now live is Dr. Allison Arwady, Commissioner of the Chicago Department of Public Health. Thank you for joining us, Doctor. You stand alongside the mayor every day. We see the numbers and we hear about the increases from you, particularly among 18 to 29-year-olds. At what point, Doctor, do you say we need to roll back the reopening plan?
Certainly. So one of the reasons why we talked about the numbers in some detail today was to let folks know that we were very close and, in fact, expect soon that it's likely we will be back into a high incidence or sort of a high risk state, which for the city of Chicago means averaging more than 200 cases per day. That does not automatically mean a rollback, but once we're at that state, that's where we start looking more seriously at where we may see places to make those changes. If we continue to see significant increases after that, that's where we would start thinking about making potentially some of those smaller rollbacks. And if we got to a point where we were seeing 300 or especially 400 cases a day, that's where we'd be thinking about needing to move back a whole phase, like into phase three, for example.
Okay, so Dr. Arwady, give us an idea of what a potential rollback looks like. You say it won't probably be a blanket rollback, but specific businesses, specific neighborhoods. I mean, kind of take us into that since that seems like it's where we're going.
Absolutely. So this is where we would really use our local data, just like we have all along. So we do investigations of all of our cases. Say, for example, we were seeing, as has been seen in some other states, significant spread related to indoor bars, just to take an example. That might be one of the earlier spaces where we would say, you know what, right now with things on the increase, potentially we'll need to close indoor bars. We're not at a point of needing to do that now, but it would be an example. Or say we were seeing a big spike in long-term care facilities again. We would say, what do we need to do to get stricter with long-term care facilities? So we're gonna use our data to really make those decisions, but pair it with messaging for where it needs to be, like the 18 to 29-year-olds that right now are making up the majority of the new cases.
So you were talking, Doctor, about some hypotheticals there, the bars and the nursing homes, but you've also been emphasizing the importance of contact tracing. Have you found any common threads with the data that shows where the virus is being quickly and easily spread?
Sure. So I'd say one thing that's different about what we're seeing in Chicago now compared to, a month or two ago, is that we're seeing it broadly in the community. We're not seeing so much very large outbreaks in a, in one setting, in a workplace setting, in a correctional facility, in a homeless shelter, a long-term care facility. We're really seeing more individual cases throughout the city, and we're seeing a lot of spread just from social interactions. And so that gets back to some of the decisions that we've made. That 18 to 29-year-old group, for example, most folks are doing the right thing, but where we looked at our data, cases in that age group were more likely to have traveled out of state, were more likely to have been in contact with friends and not just families. And so that's where we've doubled down both on the quarantine recommendation and requirement for people returning from out of state and some more messaging around making sure that people are practicing the things that we know work when they are getting together in social settings.
Today, the Trump administration mandated that hospitals send their COVID-19 data directly to the Department of Public Health and Human Services instead of the CDC, which has been collecting all that information. Some healthcare experts are concerned about that, saying that information could now potentially be less public. Do you share that concern, and what could the fallout be from that?
Yeah, absolutely. So there is a long history of reporting public health data, and it's not just about is it the CDC versus HHS. Reporting data actually comes to local and state health departments who in turn then share it with CDC. And so I worry about anything that is trying to go around our traditional public health reporting structures, because it has the potential to also leave state and local health departments, who of course are making the decisions on the ground. Here in Chicago, we have very, very strong data relationships with our hospitals already. We're working to make those even stronger with COVID. So I'm confident we'll have some backup even while this is happening, at the national level. But I do have concerns. I think it's really important that this data is made available to the scientists at CDC and that it is made available to the public. And I worry if that is potentially not going to be what happens with some of these changes. We're watching it closely.
So, Doctor, schools, they are certainly top of mind for every parent and every teacher. We're already halfway through July. Some are going fast. Do you see Chicago students going back to classrooms in the fall? And what measures need to be taken to ensure everyone's safety?
Certainly. So it's obviously been a very, very active conversation with schools here in Chicago, also with our higher education institutions. And first of all, there's a lot of thinking into various contingencies, thinking about in-person, thinking about what it means to be doing remote learning, thinking about different scenarios, and really planning, recognizing that there's not likely to be a one-size-fits-all for all families or even all school settings. And so we are planning to be sharing some more framework around this, but the final decisions will really be made based on how we're doing in our local outbreak. If our local outbreak is in reasonably good control, like it is now, you know, we would certainly be interested in supporting some in-person education, trying to make that as safe as it can be, recognizing that you cannot entirely eliminate risk. So there is still going to be a lot of conversation and planning, but I think some of those final decisions will probably not be made until August. Where we know how we're doing as a city and as a region and as a state, and that's the way it should be.
Okay, potentially August on schools. One last quick question. What is your relationship like with the mayor? Do you ever disagree? And does she listen to you? After all, kind of you're the authority when it comes to data and science.
Yeah, so I start my day every single morning with a call with the mayor. We are going over the data in detail every single day. Where are their changes? Where are their concerns? What do we need to work on? She's very interested in the data. She's very interested in the details. And I love the relationship that we have because I know I can count on her to challenge where we need to challenge. But at the end of the day, really do the things that we need to do to try to keep our city as safe as it can be while we balance things. So I'd say our relationship is very good, and I'm really glad that I'm working in a city where we are putting public health and economics above some of the political fighting that we're seeing in other settings. So it's very good, and I think she's been doing really an amazing job as a leader in this space.
Okay, Dr. Arwady, the head of the Chicago Department of Public Health, has been many moons since you've had one off, and we appreciate your hard work, and thanks for joining us.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you.